Good morning, Gethsemane Church family. I trust that all of you are doing well and things are going well with you. And I greet you in the name of Christ this morning and welcome you to this time of worship today at church. And I pray that God will bless you because you have chosen to be in worship with us this morning. Trust all of you received the phone tree message the other day. I'm not sure whether yours was, but mine was a little broken up when I got back home to listen to it. So I'm going to share that with you again, just to make sure that all of us got that message through this morning. At the request of our bishop and the committee, the cabinet, we will continue to worship as we have been, no in-place worship at this time. We'll continue that until at least May the 13th. And the bishop and the cabinet at that time will take a look at things and make a decision based on how situations are at that particular time. Even with that, based on what I'm seeing come through, I don't think worship's going to be the same. Even if we were to start back on May the 13th, I don't think it's going to be the same. There are going to be some changes, and they're going to probably recommend at that time that most of our vulnerable people continue to remain at home rather than try to come out to a public place. So we'll take a look at that when the time comes, and I'll let you know just as soon as I know more about the recommendations, and we'll get together as a committee if that time comes and let you know more about at that particular time. Now let us enter into a time of worship. Would you bow your heads in a word of prayer? Well, God, receive us now at this moment. As we come now to worship you, we pray that you would be with us this day and bless our hearts as we come now to worship and bow before you. In Christ's name, amen. We're going to be singing hymn number 365. If you got your hymnal at home, it's Grace Greater Than Our Sins. We're going to be singing three verses. Sing it with us.
Marvelous grace of our loving Lord, grace that exceeds our sins and our guilt. Yonder on Calvary's mount outpoured, there where the blood of the Lamb was spilled. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin. Sin and despair like the sea wave roll, threatens the soul with infinite loss. Grace that is greater, yes, grace untold, points to the refuge, the mighty cross. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sins. Marvelous, infinite, matchless grace, freely bestowed on all who will believe. You that are longing to see his face, will you this moment his grace receive? Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that will pardon and cleanse within. Grace, grace, God's grace, grace that is greater than all our sin.
Now let us go to the Lord in a time of prayer, if you would please. Bow with us as we pray this morning. God, we bow now in a moment of silence so that each one of us can lift our hearts and our own needs up to you at this particular time. Hear us now, God, as we pray and accept our prayers. hearts now to you this morning, and we come to affirm our faith that we already possess, to seek a deeper understanding of you, and to pledge our lives in your service. We pray, Lord, that you would help each one of us to realize that as your children, as members of the family of God, we are here in ministry in your kingdom. And, oh God, when we're weak and when we're tempted, we pray that you would sustain us. When we're lonely, we pray that you would comfort us. Keep us always open to your truth of your word, oh God. And now, Lord, once again, we lift up our country, especially at this time when we're going through this terrible pandemic. We pray, oh Lord, for those among us who are sick with this disease, that you would bring healing to their hearts. And we pray, oh God, that you would help those who are working on a solution, that you would help them be able to find a medicine that would help bring healing and that would help bring an end to this virus that we're facing. We pray for those men and women who are providing care in the hospitals and other places, Lord. They're working so hard. We lift them up to you and ask that you continue to be with them, oh God. And Lord, those that are among us that are suffering today, we lift them up and we ask, oh God, that you would be with them, that you would help them know that you're there with them in everything that they're going through. And we pray, oh God, to continue to be with us here at this church as we continue to try to serve you. And Lord, we pray now the prayer that you taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever, we pray. Amen. I want to share with you now a song. Everyone knows this song. It's a favorite of everyone. It's Amazing Grace. Just as soon as our pianist, Jacob, gets right back to the piano, we're going to sing Amazing Grace. Just a moment, we've got to make some adjustments here on some of the new camera we've got here at the church. Our scripture lesson today comes from the book of Luke, chapter 24. We're going to be talking about on the road to Emmaus, and this song, Amazing Grace, goes along with that.
Theology
in some of the country music that is sung. Now, it's not Wesleyan theology, but it's pretty good theology. Listen to the words of this song about love. It says, "Forever is as far as I'll go." Now, that's pretty good stuff when you take a look at it. It's sort of like agape love almost. Forever is as far as I'll go. Forever is a long way. That's pretty good. That's pretty good theology. Or what about this one? Listen to the words. It says, "We need to hold who needs holding, and mend what needs mending. Walk even if it means an extra mile. Pray what needs praying. Say what needs saying, because we're only here for a little while." Now that's country music, but it's pretty good theology, isn't it? It's got some pretty good stuff written there. Well, some of you know that I used to do a lot of singing back many years ago, and a lot of what I sang was some of the country music style. There was some country music that I loved to sing. And I sung here in Dublin and a lot of different venues. Sometimes I would be doing beauty pageants, maybe other kinds of things in the community, concerts, wherever it might be. And of course, country music fan, there was one particular song that I used to love to sing. Written by Willie. Now listen to the words. It says, "On the road again. Just can't wait to get on the road again. Going places I've never been. I just can't wait to get on the road again." Well, this sermon this morning is not about country music. It's not about opera music. But it is about what both country music and opera are about. It's about life. It's about life in the raw. It's about life that we experience every day, a little bit of life that we experience. And it's a good image of Willie Nelson's classic, "On the Road Again." Listen to the words again. "On the road again. Just can't wait to get on the road again. Going places that I've never been. I can't wait to get on the road again." Now, many people feel like that's bad. They feel the lostness and the loneliness, the frustration of being on the road all the time. But you know what? I don't know of a better image to describe the experience of Cleopas and his companion about whom we read in our scripture this morning than the words "On the Road Again" by Willie Nelson. It is Easter afternoon. Cleopas and his friends have been followers of Jesus, but now they have just thrown in the towel. They have quit. They have given up on life. They are limping down the Emmaus Road like a broken, defeated warriors. They know about the crucifixion. They saw it with their own eyes, but they did not yet know about the resurrection of Jesus. They have not yet experienced the risen Christ. Disappointed, disillusioned with life, defeated, heartbroken, downcast, they trudged down the Emmaus Road. Their hopes for the future had been devastated. So not knowing what else to do, they turned back towards their old life. And I can picture them in my mind right now. Their shoulders are slumped over. Their heads are bowed as though they are carrying on their backs a crushing burden of defeat and dejection. They limp along with weary steps as if their shoes were just weighted with lead. Their eyes are misted over with tears and disillusionment, and they walk along in silence. They dare not speak for fear that they will break into some uncontrollable sobbing. And at last, with a sign weighted with despair, the younger man finally speaks up. And he says, "He's dead. He's gone. It's all over. They have killed him. And without him, we're nothing. We should have known this wouldn't work. It was too good to be true. Too idealistic for this cruel world that we live in. How could we have been such fools? We followed him. We trusted him. We thought he was the one who would come and save us. And now it's all over. It's over with. He's gone." Now that is a bold portrait of the stressed, fractured spirit. Down, dejected, defeated, worn, weary, wounded young men we saw on the road to Emmaus. But beloved, that is not the end of that story. No, it's not. Suddenly, out of nowhere, the risen Christ comes to them and he walks with them. He talks with them. He opens the scripture to them. He breaks bread with them as if they, and then they experience the resurrection. They experience the resurrected Christ. So look at what happens. They too are resurrected. They're healed. They find new life. And they rush, not limping, they rush, they run. They walk all the way back to Jerusalem as fast as they can to share the good news with the other disciples. They run shouting, hope is still alive. Christ is risen. Christ is alive. He is here with us today. We have seen him. They went with all of their hearts sharing the good news. Isn't that a great story? I mean, there are so many powerful images here in this passages of scriptures. There's dramatic symbols here. It is packed full of the stuff of life. There are so many helpful lessons for us in this particular story today. There are so many different directions that one could take. But for this morning, I just want to lift up three significant insights from Dr. Jim Moore's website. And he underscores some good news about what is going on here. The good news for the people this morning who suffer from stressed, fractured spirit. So here are the words of God. First of all, lesson number one, Christ comes to us in a special way when we are hurting. He is always with us in every circumstances of life. But over the years, I have noticed that he seems to draw even closer to us when we are in pain, when we're hurting. During these times in life, we need him most, and he comes to us during those times. Cleopas and his friends were hurting that day. They were plotting along this Emmaus road, and suddenly Christ appears to them, and he gives them strength, and he gives them the strength that they need to go on in life. And my friend, that's the way it works. It seems as if it would be easy for us to feel the presence of Christ when life is bright and beautiful and all the breaks are going our way. But the truth is that Christ is never more nearer to us than when we are hurting, when life is falling in on us, when it's collapsing around us. Time after time, I've heard people say, and I know you have too, that this is the hardest thing that we've ever gone through in our life. Our hearts are broken, but we're going to be all right because God is with us as never before. And that's the way it is. He comes to us when we're hurting. He is unique and especially with us when we're hurting, and I think I know why. I think there's two reasons for that. Number one, I think first of all is because we are more open to the presence of God when we are down and out. When we're not down and out, we're not thinking about him oftentimes. But when we're down and out, we're more open to the presence of God. And secondly, I believe that God is like a loving parent who wants to be especially close to his children when they're in pain. Every parent here knows what I'm talking about. If our children are hurting, we want to be there with them. And we want to do all that we can to help them. And God is like that. This is an important lesson that explodes out of this story in Luke chapter 22, that Christ comes to us in a special way when we're down and out and when we're hurting. He comes to us in a special way. There's a second lesson, I think, that we can look at here. And the second one is that Christ has the power to heal our hurts. In Luke 24, we see how that happens. Cleopas and his friends are trudging along with this stressed, fractured, disillusioned spirit. They are completely dejected. They are down and out, and they have given up hope on life. But then Christ comes to them. Now remember what he does. He walks with them, symbolizing the importance of our daily walk with Christ. He talks with them, showing us the power of prayer. He opens the scripture to them, underscoring to us the importance of our reading our scriptures. He breaks bread with them. Obviously, it is a plug for Holy Communion, and that is one of the holiest things that we can practice in our Christian life. And then he sends them back to church. Look at it this way. Dr. Moore points out for us to see here. Here's what he says. There is prayer, There's Bible study, there's the sacraments, there's staying close to the church, and there's our daily walk with Jesus Christ. Beloved, it is through these holy habits that Christ can bring healing to our fractured spirit. Listen to me. If you have a problem today, if you're hurting in any way right now, bring that problem, that pain to Christ, because he has the power to heal our hurts and to take care of our broken hearts. And then finally, the third lesson that I want you to see is this, that Christ shares his resurrection with us. When we experience the risen Lord, we, like Cleopas and his friend, are resurrected also. We too receive new life, and he resurrects us, giving us that new life that we need so desperately. I will never forget when I was serving a church when I was in college, and it was on Easter morning, and it just happened to be that we were to set our clocks ahead that morning also. Well, we had about an hour's drive to the church from our house where we were serving. And when we got there, we drove up into the parking lot. People were leaving the church, and we couldn't understand why. People would say, "Happy Easter, Pastor, Happy Easter, Christ is risen." And when we got into the foyer of the church, I want you to know that the chairman board was standing there waiting on us. And he looked at us and he said, "Happy Easter, he is risen, and I suggest you do the same thing." You see, what had happened, we had forgotten to set our clocks ahead. And when we got there, people were leaving the church and on their way home. But I want you to know something, that next Easter morning, we were still serving that little church. And about 6 a.m., my wife had an alarm clock set all over the house. And one right after another, they started going off. It was a reminder that we needed to be resurrected. We needed to hear that message. And the message is clear, that you and I can be resurrected too. When Christ shares his resurrection with us, he rises, and so can we. We too can have a new start in life. That is the miracle of God's amazing grace. That is the miracle of what we just sang about. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Amazing grace. This is a dramatic part of the Easter story. Christ was resurrected, and so were his followers. He arose, he exploded out of the tomb, so did they, and thank God, so can we. The risen Christ has come to us in special ways that we are hurting. The risen Christ has the power to heal our hurts. And the risen Christ comes to share his resurrection with us. This is the story of God's amazing grace. I pray that God will bless it to your heart. This is God's word for this hour. I pray he will bless it to your heart and use it to continue motivating you as you serve him in his kingdom. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, I pray. Amen. Our closing song this morning is number 381, "Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us." Would you sing that with us, please?
Pleasant pastures lead us.
receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, I pray. Amen. Go in peace.